correlation is fundamentally about understanding the direction and strength of the relationships between variables. Although correlation can be used with hypothesis testing, it can also do a number of other useful jobs in research. Number one, reliability. A strong correlation between items on a test means that they are consistently measuring the same thing. If all of the items on the test correlate well, then you have a reliable test. This form of reliability is measured with a test called Cronbach's alpha. When you give the same test to the same people twice in a row, and the two administrations correlate strongly, you have test-retest reliability. Both of these are forms of correlation. Number two, validity. If you were developing a brand new test of intelligence, you would want to demonstrate that your test correlates strongly with an existing measure of intelligence. It is measuring the same construct as the first intelligence test. A strong correlation between a new test and a gold standard test means that they are measuring the same construct and that your new test is valid. The third use for correlation is prediction. If two variables are strongly correlated, such as drop in barometric pressure and increase in precipitation, the next time we see the barometer begin to drop, we can predict that it will rain soon. When two variables are correlated, when we see one change, we can predict what will happen with the other. The fourth use of correlation is for theory verification, or testing a theory. Remember that correlation does not imply causation. But if one variable is causing changes in another, they will be strongly correlated. I approach verification by saying, if my theory is correct, then this should happen. If the variables turn out to be uncorrelated, or if they are correlated in the wrong direction, then we conclude that one variable is certainly not causing changes in the other. We know that that theory is not correct. So, for example, if abstinence-only sex education in public schools decreases teen pregnancy, then I should see lower rates of teen pregnancy in places where abstinence-only sex education is taught. And I would also expect to see higher rates of teen pregnancy where comprehensive sex education and contraception use is encouraged. So, does teaching abstinence-only sex education cause a decrease in teen pregnancy? Let me see if I can verify my theory. According to Ventura, Hamilton, and Matthews, 2014, the highest rates of teen pregnancy are in states with laws requiring schools teach abstinence only. Yes, this is a correlational observation, but the association between promoting abstinence sex education in schools and increased teen pregnancy does not support the theory that abstinence education works. When we examine correlations, we see that these same states with higher rates of teen pregnancy also have lower rates of education. They're more religious. They have higher rates of health problems. Remember that correlation does not imply causation. We may want to explore the causal links among these variables. But collectively, these observations, combined with the observation that states that promote contraceptive use have the lowest rates of teen pregnancy, might cause us to be skeptical of the claims that teaching abstinence without providing contraception decreases teen pregnancy.